everybody. Thank you for coming. I'm Professor Susan Watkins, Director of the Centre for Culture and the Arts at Leeds Beckett University. I'd like to welcome you all to this Leeds Cultural Conversation, organised in partnership with Leeds City Council and the publisher Palgrave Macmillan. We're working closely with Palgrave on their campaign for the humanities. For more information about the other forthcoming talks, please visit our website. So today I'm really pleased to welcome Dr. Neil Washbourne, who is a senior lecturer in media in the School of Cultural Studies and Humanities at Leeds Beckett University. Neil's recent research has focused on two main areas. First, the relationship between media and politics in the contemporary world. His book, Mediating Politics, Newspapers, Radio, Television and Internet, was published by Open University Press in 2010. Second, Neil is also interested in the emergence and development of celebrity from the 19th century onwards, and particularly in the cricketer W.G. Grace as a national, commercial and post-colonial cultural legend, and also in radio celebrity in the 1930s. So today, as part of LGBT History Month, he will be speaking to us on the subject of W.G. Grace, cricket missionary to the North, and hero of 1895 to Oscar Wilde's villain. So join me in welcoming Neil.
Thank you very much indeed. Welcome, everybody. I've come here today to explore the fame of W.G. Grace, the Gloucestershire, England and MCC cricketer, whose first-class career extended between 1865 and 1908. 43 years, that's quite a good innings. And I'm doing that through the lens of the study of celebrity in media studies and history, so the academic disciplines have started to talk about celebrity in serious kinds of ways. I'm going to give you a couple of concepts, but don't worry too much about those. From Marshall's work, I drew upon the notion of public subjectivity, which means how and in relation to what meanings, values, and types of individual identity one is known to others. So exploring the kind of identities that are in play in various forms of celebrity. In addition to that, I use Van Creeken's notion of attention capital. I look at two phases of Grace's public career, the sporting superstardom and the place where he becomes a cultural celebrity. In using Van Creeken's notion of attention capital, I'm suggesting that as soon as somebody becomes powerfully the center of people's attention, interest, even affections, then they can end up using that attention for all sorts of other purposes, whether it's to make money, to tie their celebrity into a bunch of other kinds of practices. And that's what I'm going to explore as part of this afternoon's talk. So the first stage is sporting superstardom. His second stage, his cultural celebrity, where even those who took no interest in cricket whatsoever knew about him quite intimately and quite readily. As Susan's already suggested, I've already done some work on celebrity. In my book, Mediating Politics, I look at why it is in recent years, since the 1980s, so much focus and attention has been given to individual party leaders and political leaders rather than the broader party. And as part of that, I did a paper for an edited book on the 2010 television party leadership debates and that strange period of Clegmania. We almost forget that it ever happened. A couple of other things about the kind of work that I do. Last Friday, I started a completely new course entirely focused on contemporary celebrity called Media Celebrity and Film Stardom. And I'm also on the editorial board of the journal Celebrity Studies. So we do take this very, very seriously. The press were quite sniffy on the launch of this journal. They often are. They think about Mickey Mouse subjects and things like that. But one can study celebrity of the past, present, in other countries very seriously indeed. Grace died in October 1915, fearful of the Zeppelin raids that were annoying the residents of South London, where he then lived. And the centenary of his death on the 23rd of October 2015 led to a muted but significant commemoration of his life and so forth. I will note some of the books published during that period to mark the anniversary, because I draw upon key features of those books in making my argument. Tomlinson's biography sets out the store for what I'm doing today in two ways. Firstly, by focusing on questions that other people haven't explored before, or they've closed down avenues of investigation, as if we know all about W.G. Grace already. Secondly, by seeking out underused or unused archives and sources, and I do both of those things in this particular talk. Meredith's book is a quite melancholy exploration of what are the remains of where he lived in terms of houses and cricket grounds and things like that. What's the evidence that he ever existed in the physical and built landscapes of our lives? And Connolly does a novel on the final years, the more private years rather than the public years of W.G. Grace's life. For more cricket fan kind of organised people, Jonathan Rice produces an anthology of the coverage of Grace across Wisden's years since 1864 when it was set up. And you get the more humorous account, W.G. Grace ate my pedalo, and I should reveal my pedalo t-shirt at this sort of point. And this is a kind of lampoon where we're dealing with our relationship to the Victorians, but they're often our other in many of our kind of contemporary debates. And the Grace in the pedalo is obviously picking up on Freddie Flintoff's pedalo, drunken kind of escapades. And it borrows much that whole book from things like Viz's Victorian Dad comic strip, the kind of lampooning of the and showing our superiority to the Victorians. Tomlinson was able to draw upon a range of books that were already published in the previous 30 years in trying to articulate a much more critical, sociological and historical kind of approach towards W.G. Grace. And he also drew upon the magnificent piece of scholarship, I don't know if you've ever seen J.R. Weber's book, The Chronicle of W.G. Grace. It's 1,109 pages. I think every page which has got lots of writing on it has got at least 1,000 words. It's longer than the Bible. And I treat it as a kind of Bible, at least when I'm doing research. So following on from Tomlinson, I pursue new questions, seek under or unused archives, in particular the UK press, more available through digital and the digitisation procedures, and the Australian press, which is actually available free digitalised, so go and use the trove.au website to find out what Victorian newspapers and even more contemporary newspapers were saying in the Australian kind of setting. Very interesting both for W.G. Grace studies, but also for Oscar Wilde studies. In doing that, in thinking about these kind of questions, I've already started to make some contributions, so I'm going to just list a few of them there. Hopefully that's big enough for you to see. So it's a book chapter which draws especially on C.L.R. James's work, Beyond a Boundary, in a book looking at Beyond a Boundary 50 years since it was first published, and a series of other conference papers, Grace's body, his beardedness, how fat he was, his sporting body, which was occasionally prone to break down because of all the work that he actually did, his transatlantic fame, because he did go to the United States and Canada. So what do we make of that, and how can we conceptualise that? And a paper which was just on the relationship between Oscar Wilde and W.G. Grace in 1895. So rather today, I slightly neglect Oscar Wilde. I try to give him my best shot, but I slightly neglect him in this particular paper. So the new questions that I'm raising concern W.G. Grace's sporting superstardom and role as a cricket missionary. Cricket missionary to the north of England. And particularly in the way in which that cricket missionary work was there used and drawn upon to resolve a schism in first-class cricket that went on at least between 1864 and 1870 and had become a north-south cricket divide. One measure of his superiority as a batsman, just to establish things, is that he'd scored his 50th first-class century by the age of 27, scored between 1865 and 1875. And if you take every other first-class cricketer playing in the United Kingdom between those 10 years, you have to add up all the cricket centuries scored by the next 13 cricketers, the next 13 most prolific batsmen to equal. So he was literally extraordinary in a sort of Weberian, charismatic kind of way. The second question to which I devote at least equal attention this afternoon is the cultural crisis manifest in the public discussion of the Oscar Wilde scandal, around the libel trial and the two criminal trials which took place leading up to May the 22nd, 1895, when it was kind of resolved. One thing to note, I'm mainly dealing in this paper with first-class cricket, but there was lots of other kinds of cricket going on. Matches, and this is a kind of definition, matches between teams of 11 players each, played over at least 2 days, with each team having two innings, and the players being judged to be of sufficient quality so to qualify as first class. That meant most county cricket clubs playing each other, and the county cricket clubs of Yorkshire and Gloucestershire were founded in 1863 and 1870, respectively, and they played first-class matches. And so did some of the time the professional touring 11s, about which I'm going to talk a little bit more in a moment. The MCC itself played a lot of first-class matches, and the big representative matches like gentlemen versus players and north versus south were also first-class. Okay. So Grace used his mission, his cricket superstardom to perform missionary work from the late 1860s for a sect of cricket, later what I might consider its national church. It wasn't going to the heathens. There was another religion of cricket going on, especially in the north of England. And so it's that interplay between this sect with the superstardom. Cricket in this theology centred on the Marylebone Cricket Club in London with its headquarters at Lord's, is a mystical game which is seen to best prepare men for command and obedience and to develop healthy bodies and other virtues. It's what Mangan in his works on the public schools has called the ideology of cricket, and it offers very subordinate positions to professionals as not fully inhabiting the masculine social status attributed to the products of public school system and so forth. Brady argues that masculine social status was the most important social status in that last sort of last third of the end of the 19th century. And it's based upon around three sets of relationships predominantly between men. Men in the workplace, and cricket clearly is a workplace as well as anything else. Men in the workplace, men in clubs and clubland, and cricket clubs are clubs as well, with subscription members as well as popular ones just coming on to one-off matches. And also the relationship between men, women, children, and younger men in the household. I borrowed the idea of cricket missionary from Lowe's biography, where he discusses Grace a little bit in these terms without really committing to the metaphor, around his visits to Canada and the United States in 1872 to 1873. He presents young Grace as a zealous young prophet, even comparing him to Theodore Herzl, the founder of Zionism, saying that there's a kind of resemblance between them. And you can see there's quite a serious look. You could imagine if you had a close-up of that face on the left-hand side that it could possibly be some strange revolutionary from the sort of later Russian sort of 19th century. So there's an intensity to the pictures of the early Grace, the not fat Grace, and we have to see him in that kind of light, using this intensity of play, but also to an intensity of a commitment to a certain set of what he perceived of as ideals, as well as quite practical solutions to his own problem of playing cricket on a regular basis. I argue this was far truer and more consequential regarding Grace's role in the United Kingdom to see him as a cricket missionary, especially in the north of England, rather than that relationship being played out in the United States and Canada. The sect that he then supported, the Marylebone Cricket Club sect, the public school kind of sect of cricket, was opposed and consciously opposed to what was considered to be a de-civilizing effect consequent upon the dominant form of cricket at that time when he started his career in 1865, which was professional touring 11s. Their motives were profit and remunerative professional employment. They're captained and organized by professional cricketers. And this is the first of those 11s founded in 1846, a very important year for political moments. I've tried to track down in the past whether there's links to Chartism. There must be, because a lot of it's coming out of Nottingham. In fact, the first captain and organiser and employer of that team, William Clark, was himself a Nottingham-born player. Claims to the gentleman amateur precedence can be found in a very stark form as early as 1866 in the Land and Water magazine, and I'll read it out to you because it's not the predominant way that this relationship is talked about, but it's one ferocious one coming from a particular kind of landed gentry aristocratic kind of angle. So in 1866, just as we employ grooms because we do not care to rub down our own horses, and gamekeepers because we do not care to feed our own pheasants, but we have no intention of letting the former go out fox hunting on the cream of a stud, or putting the latter in the warm corner of our best cover. In a word, then, professionals are necessary as an accommodation to amateurs, and their position ought to be secondary and subsidiary one. So although not everybody in the kind of MCC kind of led sect of cricket shared the exact nature of that judgment and how it was made, they did share some aspects of that sentiment, the subsidiary relationship of the professionals. The professional touring cricket 11s helped forge cricket as a truly national pastime and preoccupation and a first-class sporting activity in the decades from 1846 onwards. When Grace appeared as a first-class cricketer from 1865, he proved his superiority, as I suggested before. So superior was he that when he occasionally failed, a big hoo-ha was made of it. So the Daily Telegraph in 1869 commented on a score of zero, of naught, by Grace bowled third ball in a match, that to understand what the hoo-ha was about this, one must imagine Adelina Patti, the opera singer, singing outrageously out of tune. Imagine Mr. Gladstone violating all the rules of grammar, and you have some faint idea of the surprise created by this incident. Grace aligning himself with the gentleman amateur MCC became perhaps the most crucial factor and catalyst enabling the MCC to become accepted as the preeminent court of appeal of cricket, and thereafter the club providing the most employment opportunities for professional cricketers. This despite the fact that he came from a middle-class provincial family of doctors and attended neither public school nor Oxbridge, which was somewhat held against him. The most important element of W.G. Grace's Northern cricket missionary work took place either playing against Yorkshire or in Yorkshire, usually Sheffield, where the county headquarters then was, and there was later on a kind of a series of schisms, and eventually the county headquarters comes to Leeds. And Bradford and York were probably other key cities for big cricket, amateur or professional, in Yorkshire at the time. I'm going to look at three Yorkshire cricketers just to tell a little bit of that tale of how that missionary work worked. Roger Iddison on the far left, who was then a professional captain of the Yorkshire County Cricket Club. Tom Emmett in the middle, a fast bowler, played for Yorkshire from 1866 to 1888 and also for England. And on the far right, Lord Hawke, captain of playing for the gentlemen of Yorkshire from 1875, playing for the county club from 1881 and being captain from 1887. At that point then being the gentleman amateur in charge rather than a series of professionals still being used to captain the Yorkshire county side. Iddison accidentally, and not, it seems, by malice, actually created the key part of this schism. There had been some argy-bargy between southern professionals and northern professionals since the late 1850s, especially around Surrey, the relationship between Surrey players and Yorkshire players. But he was commissioned in September 1864 to organise the team to represent the north, to play against the south in Islington. It was quite difficult to do because many of the northern professionals already had commitments to those touring 11s that I sort of mentioned. So he had to get together a scratch side, not the best possible side that could be put out, and he himself couldn't be present, so he put it in charge of his brother William Iddison. William Iddison, his brother, failed to turn up for the match, caused a lot of kerfuffle. The southern professionals didn't like it, and they didn't like the fact that the Northern Star professionals weren't there. They took it as an affront to their own dignity, let alone any other consequences for their careers. Consequently, the Southern professionals issued a declaration that they would no longer play in another North versus South contest, and they also cancelled their membership in both the All England and United All England 11s and set up another one, the United South of England 11. So you've got a schism for 5 or 6 years where Northern professionals and Southern professionals hardly played against each other and maintained separate circuits. Northern professionals interpreted the creation of this new 11, to some extent quite rightly, as a dire threat to the loss of their summer earnings. Iddison banded together with four of his other Yorkshire County teammates, got embroiled with the Sheffield Committee of the Yorkshire County Cricket Club, and all were suspended. And for several years after 1864, there was hardly any first-class cricket played by the Yorkshire County Club issuing from Sheffield. Some of it did from Bradford, some of it did from other parts of the county. This schism caused a massive decline in the number of matches between Southern and Northern county cricket sides, and a retrenching of Northern professionals to matches not 11 against 11 and first class, but against 16s, 18s and 22s, obviously meant to be matches largely to make money rather than equal prestigious cricketers sort of battling against each other. Actually, to some degree, this suited their purposes financially because they didn't have to do the big travelling, which was highly costly in time and money, and it was perfectly okay in terms of continuing a career as a professional cricketer. They caused a problem, though, because this was an unstable situation, this divide between North and South. Firstly, it was unstable because the new 11 set up by the Southern professionals, the United South of England 11, signed Grace in 1870. And so his attention capital was with them, and they became by far the most popular of those touring 11s. So whenever you went to the other touring 11s, it was kind of like getting second best. Secondly, county cricket clubs expanded the total amount of cricket they were playing, first-class games, within the fold of the MCC, so they accepted these are the ones who were kind of in charge as the final court of appeal for all of our decisions, and actually increased the number of possibilities for professionals playing for them. Thirdly, the MC increasingly required qualifications for playing for cricket clubs. Iddison himself was actually, even though he played for Yorkshire for so many years, was the first player to play to score a century for Lancashire. So they were a bit willy-nilly about who they played for. But now the MCC brought in qualifications, either by birth or by residence. And if you didn't have either of those, you shouldn't be playing for that county at all. And secondly, you should only play for one county club during any particular season. And this forced professionals to make decisions about the likely source of future employment rather than pick and choose amongst a very wide array of options. And fourthly, tactically, even strategically, WG Grace became available to play for professionals' benefit matches. And benefit matches are really important in cricket, especially in those days. Basically, they were deferred payments to control what the cricketer did. And so you wanted a big payout because that really might be your retirement as you got into your 40s and perhaps could no longer compete. Grace being available with his attention capital, his superstardom, ensured they were well attended, had high quality play, and that increased press attention meant a good payout, encouraged also a paternalistic relationship to professional beneficiaries. And this is a minor part of the result of Roger Iddison's benefit match played in 1872 at Bramall Lane in Sheffield. W.G. Grace seemed to outdo himself on that particular day, 150 and 15 for 79, but they managed to keep the game going for the days that it was on and have a big payout and large crowds. So you're talking 20,000 crowds at Bramall Lane on any particular day. Iddison was rehabilitated into the Yorkshire side after the schism and in relation to that dominant sect of cricket. In fact, even becoming a cricket coach in three different public schools, not what would happen if your respectability was at all suspect. Especially in the eyes of the gentlemen amateurs themselves. Tom Emmett, the second of our Yorkshire cricketers, was not especially associated with the schism, even though he played from 1866 onwards to 1888 for Yorkshire, and he also played for England. He became a famous cricketer, and like Grace himself, was also seen as a bit of a personality. Also makes a difference to how you're seen by the public, not just a great cricketer, but somehow an engaging person. That draws the affectionate attention of the crowds. He was thus reported in the press not only for his fine performances, but also for his humorous antics and remarks. However great his own play and interesting his personality, it proved, though, in press coverage that these remarks were often subordinate to Grace and often presented as a commentary on the greatness of Grace. so. The first big visit of W.G. Grace to Sheffield occurred in 1869, playing for South versus North at Bramall Lane. And a few days before this match took place, the Reverend E.S. Carter met Ton Emmett at Lord's and was chatting to him about W.G. Grace. And he was basically saying, well, he's not as good as he thinks he is he? He's all right. It's all very well against the South Country bowling, but let him come up to Sheffield against me and George. And he met George Freeman, his kind of player in tandem of the fast bowlers. Carter actually managed to see him 2 days after the match as well, and he asked him, and supposedly the response was quite serious, and this was published in newspapers, what did you think of him now then? Mr. Carter, he said, I call him a nonsuch. He ought to be made to play with a littler bat. Okay, second time that Tom Emmett is subordinate to Grace and somehow recognises Grace's qualities is a match and a much smaller score there in the second innings. The MCC versus Yorkshire at Lord's in 1870. Gray, in his biography, talks about a ferocious assault by two Yorkshire fast bowlers. It was a very bouncy pitch, and it was a pitch until the 1870s you could kind of pick stones up off. The ball could fly left, right and centre. Grace's legs resembled beaten stakes at the end of this innings of 66. And Emmett was quoted in the press saying, I verily believe there wasn't a square inch that wasn't black and blue after that score. So Grace battered by the bowling of Freeman and Tom Emmett. We barked his shins, battered his thighs, skinned his fingers, rattled his ribs, pounded his chest, thumped his elbow, made a mark on his back. He didn't seem to mind. So suddenly you get a respect, and not a construction of the North as the kind of the tough, serious ones with the real skill, but actually, you can stand up to our best kind of approaches. And I'll give you one final instance. So his superiority was kind of recognised, but also narrated through the stories from Tom Emmett, one of the most popular of those Yorkshire cricketers, and for the press themselves. 1876, a bit of a kind of... another height over a very hot August, between the 10th and 19th of August, so consecutive matches. Grace scored 344 against Kent for the MCC, also took some wickets. Scored 177 for Gloucestershire versus Nottinghamshire, and took 8 for 69 in Notts' second innings. And at that point, the Nottinghamshire players coming away from Clifton in Bristol met the Yorkshire players coming to the Cheltenham and talked about, you know, the scores that he'd been making against them, and said, well, even the big un, so now he gets this sort of little, this sort of special name, even the big un, said Emmett, couldn't do it three times, I'd shoot him first. The following morning, once Grace had got up to over 200 on the first day of the match, 200 not out, Emmett said to his teammates, dang it all, it's Grace before meat, Grace afterwards and Grace all day, and I expect we shall have more Grace tomorrow. The county captain, a professional, found that the Yorkshire bowlers started to refuse to bowl. So there was a little sort of mini crisis in that particular kind of match. Thus, by the 1870s, the professional 11s fell away in importance, and the aristocrat-led, even if more in symbolic roles like presidents of county cricket clubs, took up much more of the slack in the growing demand for cricket, both as private clubs funded through subscriptions and providers of one-off seats for large-scale cricket crowds. Lord Hawke, playing for Yorkshire from 1881 and becoming captain in 1887, in a sense reinforced for the first time fully in Yorkshire this amateur code. He became a close friend of W.G. Grace's, and he was one of the people who co-edited the official MCC biography of W.G. Grace, produced in 1919 after the war and Grace's death in 1915. He's most famous for saying he prayed God that no professional ever captains England. And the most sympathetic account you can give of this claim is that within the gentleman amateur eulogisation of cricket, he hoped that there would always be suitably qualified amateurs to take on the task, rather than that he hated the professionals. But he did treat them paternalistically and got to decide whether their performances merited income. It used to be that there was talent money. If you scored 50, you got a certain amount of money. If you got 100, a certain amount of money. 5 wickets, a certain amount of money. So people could end up becoming greedy and focus on their individual performances, at least so the theory went. Instead, he wrote down in his little book what he thought were valuable contributions and then paid people at the end of the season. And they had to trust that he'd done that in some kind of systematic manner. Grace's great superiority over all other contenders also we can see in the history of Todmorden Cricket Club. This is 6 consecutive matches that WG Grace played, a couple of them in Yorkshire, one of them against Yorkshire in Clifton. And although he's really known for his batting, he takes 10 wickets in every single match, 6 consecutive matches. And even if he fails comparatively at Todmorden for the United South of England against the United North of England, we can see that it wasn't just sort of a couple of seasons that he was the most superior batsman. He was superior and used that superiority especially to go to Yorkshire. He went to Lancashire as well. He played in Nottinghamshire. But it was as if he were targeting Yorkshire as the ones that needed converting, the ones that were the most resistant to the sect. Grace's great superiority as a batsman over all contenders between, say, 1865 and 1877 existed in parallel with the rise of interest in cricket in county and town clubs, in the church, in the army, and amongst the public, crowds and readers, and in public schools, where Mangan argues that during this period cricket became compulsory, organised and eulogised. It gave him enormous and establishment-rich attention capital. And all the public and commercial institutions had reasons to seek to employ him or use representations of him. So we're now moving a little bit more into the second phase, thinking about his cultural celebrity. How does his cultural celebrity relate to that cricket ideology of that's not cricket, the idea of fair play and those kind of things, but led by sort of amateur and gentleman and amateur institutions? The MCC, other of those amateur institutions, represented cricket as a civilised, often pastoral, even bucolic, wholesome, fair play manliness, the Anglican Church's version of which emphasised muscular Christianity. Kynaston, in his book, it's actually a whole book about one match that W.G. Grace played, a gentleman players match of 1898, which coincided, was made to coincide with his 50th birthday. In his book, he notes that it remains a major mystery of the Victorian age, how cricket actually transformed itself from a game into a quasi-mystical institution. And though it's not my particular concern here to produce an answer, I think consideration of Grace's cultural celebrity, not just cricket superstardom, brings us closer to having such an answer. The civilising critic ideology was mapped onto Grace as the major object of affective, emotional attention, and had the consequence that Grace became increasingly a cultural celebrity at a time when his sporting superstardom only comparatively waned. Though I've neatly divided these two stages of Grace's public career chronologically, we find evidence of him being referred to as that kind of celebrity even fairly early in his career. In 1872, for example, The Sporting Life commented, showing their ambivalence about the whole of these developments and the whole phenomenon under examination, they commented, "With that extraordinary love of mobbing celebrities that seems indigenous to the British public, especially that portion of which frequents cricket grounds, Mr. Grace has to pass to his dressing room through a living lane of excited, hand-clapping people, who had, directly the last wicket fell, rushed to the pavilion enclosure like a swarm of bees to applaud and stare at the Gloucester gentleman. That the applause was well merited, we grant, but was the manner of giving it pleasant to the recipient or delicate on the part of the donors? However, Mr. Grace must now be well used to such scenes." His cultural celebrity, rather than just his cricket superstardom and the public subjectivity, the kind of identity that was associated with it, seemed to be a strange hybrid, a combination of the following. The sporting superstardom itself, meaning specific to that critic ideology of the gentleman amateur, And that's supported by the fact that Grace wasn't just a performer, he also wrote articles for the Boy's Own paper and other publications in that manly Christian kind of ideology. Also, his role as a leader of men, he was a captain and also a selector, eventually a national selector for the test team. There's a hybrid amalgam of references to his cricketing star brothers, three of whom played in the first test played in England in 1880. His Gloucestershire family in interviews and his memoirs and in biographies of him. There's also the often forceful, colourful personality. And further than that, in several instances, what we might call his over-enthusiastic competitiveness bordering on cheating. For example, we wouldn't have had the test series between England and Australia called the Ashes if he hadn't knocked over the stumps of a batsman backing up against the spirit of the game, but not against the laws. So it started a kind of a greater intensity of competition and kind of vituperation between the two sides, which itself was partly welcomed by the public. The latter in particular, that almost on the edge of cheating, perhaps even actively cheating, actually appeared to endear him to crowds and to audiences. A merely squeaky clean persona, of course, has limits in enabling affective communication and connection to the public. In this second part of the presentation, I'm exploring cultural celebrity and how Grace's name had become symbolic of his age in Oscar Wilde's apt claim about himself in relation to his great resurgence of a batsman in 1895. Wilde, too, had become a cultural celebrity since he emerged in the early from university and in the early 1880s. In fact, he actively courted it in search for a role. He became famous, even a little notorious, in roughly 1882 or so, when he went on a lecture tour of the United States, sort of illustrating the aesthetic persona that was manifest in Gilbert and Sullivan's Patients. That figure, and much of Wilde's subsequent public subjectivity, relates to the following issues. So, in the other paper where I just focus, another paper I've given where I just focus on Oscar Wilde and W.G. Grace in 1895, I can go into this in much more detail and do a satisfactory thing. But here I'm just lighting up on some of the key issues that seem to connect to what made him a distinctive personality. Aesthetics as an end in itself, and especially versus athletics, so in tension potentially with that critic ideology. A model of aesthetics, especially later into the 1880s and into the 1890s, which, according to Torrell Moy, was against the dominant aesthetic theory of the time, the sort of everyday aesthetic theory that most people espoused. She calls it aesthetic idealism. In that everyday aesthetic theory, the true, the beautiful, and the good are all congruent with each other. You kind of can produce art which is moral and of high tone and things like this. And this was a central object of the critique and the questioning that Oscar Wilde brought to the fore. For him, aesthetics was a realm important in its own, not subordinate to, and not really in the end related to the true or the good. They became irrelevances. The aesthetic was a focus itself. Another aspect was a question of effeminacy. So against some of the hearty athletic masculinities, some forms of masculinity were considered effeminate. But at that point, it wasn't straightforward that effeminacy meant anything to do with sodomy or homosexual identity. It wasn't clear how it mapped onto other aspects of masculine self-identities. Dorian Gray in the early 1890s was a watershed in his reputation because it produced a more notorious sense of his public personality, the idea that the novel that he'd written was immoral. In fact, clearly some of the responses found it an extremely ambiguous work, as if written as a text and palimpsest simultaneously. So, you know, and it actually got re-edited. It started as a series of magazine kind of supplements, and it was later re-edited heavily in response to some negative reviews. His plays of 1893 to 1895 also contributed to his public persona in terms of both his utterances and the images that were circulated about him. Paradox, aestheticism, immorality and amorality were associated with some of his works. But those popular witty absurdities, as some people have claimed it, have been focused on by Wilde scholars in the last 25 years to actually be something rather more serious going on there. They say that those plays and some of his other works have put into fundamental question the fixed identities that were underwritten by Victorian public values and realist art forms. So they're sort of saying it looks like it's a trivial kind of set of jokes, but actually something more fundamental is saying, actually, these identities aren't fixed. That superstardom and that masculine identity is actually on the quiver. Its foundations aren't perfectly clear. Dorian Gray and lots of other of Wilde's writings, both published and unpublished, appear to have been on trial as much as his own actions, relations, and personality in those libel and two criminal trials of 1895. So, now to 1895. Cricket had been wonderfully foregrounded that year, since the telegraphically communicated, wonderfully close, painfully exciting and fluctuating England-Australia test series of 1894 to 1895 was merely fading somewhat in people's thoughts and imaginings. It takes a long time in those days, doesn't it, get back from Australia? So it's just slightly fading in people's imaginings, all that enthusiasm, as the England team arrived home and the captain, Drew Stoddart, was recognised as the amateur beau ideal of manliness, both as cricketer and rugby international. Cricket was also additionally foregrounded by the fact that there was an extended and expanded array of first-class counties competing in 1895, including Essex, and then Derbyshire had re-entered the first-class stakes. So a greater number of county fixtures played, a wider national spread of excitement, and more offers and more possibilities for supporting one's own sort of county club. Grace's magnificent batting and accumulation of extraordinary records in 1895, a kind of resurgence of batting superstardom, also further foregrounded cricket. He scored his 100th first-class century, he scored 1,000 runs before the end of May, and all completed in a style which suggested the rejuvenescence of this 47-year-old and rather stout frame. All this drew crowd and press attention to him, which was only somewhat shared with Stoddart, as dual manifestations of the virtues that a great many Victorians attributed to that civilising sport. They were joined as waxworks in Madame Tussauds for the bank holiday, August bank holiday of 1895, and the photograph here is a picture of the waxwork of W.G. Grace that stayed in Madame Tussauds at least until the 1920s, and since they never got back to me or have asked them, I don't know if it went on further than that. I shall seek further knowledge. Grace's cultural celebrity and the persona of the good English cricket outdoors manliness associated with it became dramatically counterposed to the degenerate and criminal lack of manliness as constructed in many newspapers, magazines, and so forth. I should acknowledge a debt here to Asa Briggs. There's a short paragraph on the Wilde Grace relationship in 1895 in his Social History of England, published in the 1980s, and it's the most I've ever seen written about it then or since. Wilde's second criminal trial ended on the same time, on the same day, in May 1895, as Grace and Gloucestershire County Cricket Club completed an astounding win versus Kent at Gravesend. Grace was on the field for every single minute of this three-day match. He took 2 wickets for 42, not particularly amazing, scored 257 in the first innings, 73 not out, to wrap up victory just as the kind of shades of night were kind of appearing upon the horizon. Grace's cultural celebrity was constantly, though rarely explicitly, juxtaposed to Oscar Wilde's. The story is on the same page of the newspaper. Subsequent press coverage noted the banquets in honour of Grace, the letter from the Prince of Wales extolling his manly cricketing virtues, the debate over whether he should receive a knighthood. Perhaps the most dominant and long-lasting of these commemorations can be seen in newspaper coverage of the National Shilling Testimonial Fund raised to Grace, sort of equally between the Daily Telegraph, the MCC and Gloucestershire County Cricket Club, but really the Telegraph kind of takes over and takes and becomes the centre of that commemoration. And that carried on between June and October 1895 when he got the money, not that far short of £10,000. Which is a goodly sum, I think, in 1895. This demonstrated the newspaper coverage, not just of the testimonial but ongoing stories, demonstrated an ongoing fating and rewarding of Grace and the manly values associated with him, and Wilde's sentencing, his going bankrupt, his abject humiliation in prison, each of which further removed Wilde from masculine social status and demonstrated claims of the wrongfulness of him as an identity, as a persona in mind, body and spirit. Three main themes predominated in the positive validation of Grace and the sort of, you know, Wilde as the villain of the piece. Firstly, masculinity and manliness and what they meant, why they were so important and how Grace represented an ideal, and Wilde's sorry and even criminal lack. Though actually, Wilde sought to articulate a version of masculine social status, one that pushed the world to one side, one that pushed the household world to one side, and actually replayed or played out a different set of the homosocial relations of clubland that were also going on in cricket in their different ways, playing out the Hellenically inspired relations between older, wiser men and beautiful and moldable younger men. So it was actually a modified version of that masculine social status that was at play, but one seen very negatively in much of the press. So firstly, masculinity and manliness. Secondly, outdoorsness. Grace was represented as outdoors, as brown as a berry. The game of cricket contributing to health and strength by being outdoors and running around and so forth. And Wilde associated, literally in the trial transcripts, with shuttered and curtained rooms, smelling of scents and unguents, and morally compromised by that very darkness. Thirdly, their relationship to youth. Wilde's trials emphasised the young men, mostly renters, what we would call rent boys now, male prostitutes, that he had unclear, what was seen as bizarre, relationships with, seemingly relationships built around consumption, hotels, private dining rooms, and involving lavish presents for no particular reason, so it seemed. Grace was represented as both youthful in himself, sometimes being as lively as a young boy or as lively as a kitten, having the zest and enthusiasm of a schoolboy, and as well as being an ennobling or apt example to youth. And in both cases, it wasn't just general references to youth, the youth were represented in images and stories, including Grace's own son, who came to the age of 21 in 1895, played in the Oxford-Cambridge sort of cricket match, and Grace went there as the expectant, you know, the nervous father in frock coat and silk hat, and was reported in the newspapers not just as the cricketer, but also as the dad. He was extolled, his virtues were extolled both from the pulpit and the music hall stage, and you don't usually get that combination going on. Just as the banquets had brought together nonconformists and Anglicans in the same setting. So even the very commemoration of it seems to bind some aspects of symbolic aspects of society in a way which other activities don't. The Marquess of Queensberry, who brought out the libel case against Oscar Wilde, seemed to rule himself out as a fine example of manliness, despite being a bit of a, you know, but into horse racing himself, developing the rules of boxing, because of his public difficulties with his own sons, which ended up in cartoons and illustrations in the newspaper. This particular newspaper attributed the punch to the Marquess and claimed the recipient was Alfred or Bosie. It's actually Percy who was involved in this fracas in the street in 1895. But clearly he then can't be the great example of masculinity they're looking for to counter Oscar Wilde, because he's too contentious. He clearly has not bridged these masculine social relationships in appropriate kind of manners. Grace's cultural celebrity was also situated with an array of stories with other celebrities, as a chorus of supporting commentary. The Daily Telegraph itself, the disgraced head of the Liberator Building Society, Jabez Balfour, on the far left there, was witness keeping up with press coverage of Grace's scores at his own trial, which was such a complicated financial trial that somehow it didn't take off as a narrative in its own vein. E.J. Milliken's fictional low-life Ari character that had been around in Punch, and that's the one in the middle there, since 1877, didn't really take an interest in cricket usually, but he took an interest in it and kind of took an interest in those more kind of disreputable, tough, masculine, rather than the kind of the more elaborate code of and of cricket, sort of took an interest in cricket to kind of defend and promote the W.G. Grace. So you get supporting characters in that sort of as other supporting cultural celebrities, and you also get contrasting figures. Arthur Orton, the Tichborne claimant, finally admitted it wasn't he who was Roger Tichborne, but rather a man from Wapping, and also known as Thomas Castro from Wagga Wagga. So that, those various stories that go back to the 1860s and 1870s sort of also have their play out here. The Marquess of Queensbury, and on the far right, George Giffen, often known as the Australian WG, who performed superbly in the 1894 to 1895 Test series, and who was having his own benefit match and his own testimonials in Australia. Such was the power of the attention capital granted to W.G. Grace through these multiple commemorations. People were worrying that they were getting no money. At that point, the testimonial fund for Giffen had been going for a month, and they'd managed to raise £5. It got a bit better as he went later on, but notice he gets caught up in this story as well, and that features something about the attention capital, not just in the UK, but in the broader reaches of empire and the dominions. In these stories, Grace is noted as hero. The reading of his cultural celebrity is in the ruling civilising ideology of cricket, but also combined with the needs of commercial print culture. Grace's cultural celebrity was deployed to reassure, to replace the dominant press coverage of the Wilde scandal with consideration of the undegenerate hero of 100 centuries, able to gloss contemporary British society as healthy, masculine and vital, and hold off what were genuine feelings of decline, worry and uncertainty that seemed endemic. The Daily Telegraph's coverage of the Grace National Shilling Testimonial Fund, as I said before, went from June all the way through to October when he got the money. Every single day there was a column. One of the things that happened if you sent in your money is that you got listed in those columns. So it was partly kind of showing off, wasn't it? And they even featured little stories about, oh, it's lots of soldiers this time have given it, or a duke and his six sons have given some money, or sometimes somebody offering the widow's mite, the smallest coin that it was possible for them to have. Ari Adott wants us to stop at this point thinking about the Wilde scandal to sort of say, what's going on when we make this public? It's a little bit more complicated than we think it is, and that's crucial to understanding how the public thought about this and debated this. When things are made public in late Victorian print media, firstly, claims and representations are circulated to large-scale readerships. Secondly, being made public means that your neighbour knows much of what you know, and you know that they know what you know, and they know that you know that they know that too. So there's a kind of reflexivity built into it. What Ari Adott argues is one of the things that came out of that reciprocal relationship between, as soon as it's made fully public, you have to account for it, and even secondary personas have to account for their relationship to the broader debate. He argues that then some of the people spending their shilling were just supporting W.G. Grace, but some of them were also spending their shilling to work against Oscar Wilde. That was as much their motive as supporting W.G. Grace. Max Beerbohm, sort of part of Oscar Wilde's circle, said he gave a shilling to the testimonial fund as a protest against golf. But he always was a cussed sod, I think, Max Beerbohm. So, were people declaring their allegiance to W.G. Grace, their allegiance against Oscar Wilde, or a strange combination of both? Some spent their shilling or joined a cricket club to ward off suspicions that they were wild or as wild, whatever that was constructed as, or simply were not heir to masculine social status as a system of social division and control, which commenced in earnest with cricket but modelled and influenced the political class and gender segregations present in Victorian public and private life. I just want to say some tiny thing afterwards as a sort of coda to the paper, because that's pretty much it. There's a subsequent history, I think, and with Wilde we know the subsequent history, and with Grace kind of it's a hidden history, but it still has its effects, and I just wanted to address that kind of that linking. Through the subsequent history of the Wilde scandal is tied up with more open social and personal relationships and identity possibilities developed by bohemians, of various classes from the 1920s to the 1940s. In the 1950s and 60s campaigns seeking decriminalisation of sex between men, Hollywood films articulating and lesbian and gay social movements establishing Wilde as a gay martyr, though at the time it wasn't perfectly clear that that identity was available to be taken up in a clear way, so it's a kind of looking back and a reconstructing. It's important also to focus upon grace because the masculine social status and the constructions of it there are consequential in terms of what you associate with cricket or sports, or how you associate what goes on in a public school and the ideas that we value and so forth. W.G. Grace formed a key figurehead for these particular versions of masculine social identity, and it's through that battle over the cultural celebrity that positions were shored up and defended for another or even more than one generation in the workplace, in clubland, and in the household. Thank you very much indeed for your attention.
Does anyone
have any questions?
Yes. Was Wilde, were you saying, seen as a, by some as a version of masculinity, or by some, by others, as the very opposite of masculinity, which was a general thing, I suppose, or was he just parallel to masculinity?
Depends over the years. Clearly, he was married in 1885 and he had children, so they were some signifiers of masculinity.
At the trial. Sort of
symbolically, clearly, he was separated from a lot of those things, from his children, who then they were advised, the mother was advised to change their names. There are not very much references in the newspapers linking him back to the family. So it's almost as if the public coverage isolates him from that to construct him as this strange isolate who doesn't fit in with those sort of those major parameters. I think there's a lot of the coverage is also completely confused about exactly how to pin this down. One thing that we also have to bear in mind is that, and this is partly based on the work of Harry Cox, a historian, the last time I knew him he was working at Sussex, but maybe he's moved somewhere else now. He looked at the press between the sort of 1850s and 1890s. And there seems to have been a kind of agreement after a series of sodomy trials in the 1860s that the papers would no longer print that word, even if somebody was going to be tried for sodomy, which in the end, of course, Oscar Wilde was not tried for sodomy. But if you look at the trial transcripts and they came to light in the early 2000s and were published, sodomy appears, or sodomitical appears about 50 or 60 times, even though in the end he was not tried. He was tried for gross indecency. So clearly, that word couldn't be used. So if you wanted to articulate that, you articulate other things. In some of the Australian press, it's the image of sewers, the images of darkness that I talked about. So not so much directly his masculinity, except the inappropriate relationships there. So people drew their own conclusions about the inappropriate masculine social relationships, which were also inappropriate class relationships sometimes, or status group relationships. If you come to the next talk, you'll have access to the thinkings of Ruth Robbins, who is much more, who is an expert on Oscar Wilde in a way that I'm a sort of absolute amateur on Oscar Wilde, even though I read lots about him and looked at the kind of press. And I hope that's helped you a little bit with your question.
Thank you.
Yes.
Sorry.
W.G. as a sham amateur.
Yes.
How did that affect it, the public image of it? Especially when he went over to Australia and he got more money than anybody else. The other ones were scraping around and hadn't had any food and stuff like this. Well, he was going around.
Yeah.
How did that affect his
At various stages, most of the biographers who address this question say at various stages when his form dropped off, then questioning came to the fore.
Yes.
So in 1879, it came to the fore, and it went in a couple of newspapers tried to push it, or a couple of sporting magazines tried to push it, and it didn't take off elsewhere. The Australian press was much more open about it. They just called a thing by its proper name and sort of said, yes, he clearly is a fake amateur, isn't he? The only way in which he's not a fake amateur, and Tomlinson addresses this in his most recent biography, this 2015 commemoration biography, because he says, well, actually, people have exaggerated how much money he got, And he actually had many more outgoings than people know. So it wasn't mere greed. He nearly always was supporting other elements of his family. But it is absolutely true. If you think of the 1891 to 92 tour of Australia, it was privately financed by Lord Sheffield, and Grace was paid his expenses and £3,000. So, and that, I think the professionals who went got a tenth of that. They got their £300 and their expenses, and not so elaborate expenses for booze. Always with professionals, they didn't. The booze wasn't part of the expenses they had. When Lord Hawke took over charge of Yorkshire in 1887, somebody said to him, "Oh, it's Lord Hawke and 10 beer cans," because they were considered to like a drink. But yes, clearly the shamateurism came up in various things. Sidney Pardon, the sort of later editor of Wisdom, sort of up to the First World War, said, custom curtsies to great kings. So they knew he was a fake amateur in lots of ways. He was just so necessary that rarely did it become questioned at such a level that it dominated debate. In 1896, the year after this, there was a strike of professionals for playing for England because the Australians were over. And the Australians were treated all as amateurs, but they came over and made quite a lot of money, not usually directly from cricket playing, but from other associated and allied enterprises. And so this stuck in the craw of the British, English qualified professionals, much more than the fact that they were real shamateurs, because Stoddart himself refused to play for England in 1896 because he knew he was a shamateur. Because you, as an amateur, unless you're from a very wealthy background, you cannot afford to play that game full time just on expenses, because it won't fly. But yeah, he was a shamateur, and it was only under certain conditions that that was particularly kind of raised, and often then only got raised on the periphery of the debate rather than right at the heart of it.
Was, but it was simply that the idea, one of the problems with press coverage, just generally, then as now, is that it simplifies. In a way, in order to tell the story, you have to flatten out all the shades of grey. So what they were doing with the Wilde trials was to make him look effeminate, a bit of a pansy, I think is the, you know, that's the sort of phrase that would come to mind now, which stands really neatly against the athletic, though quite fat, WG. but in both cases, neither of those things is absolutely true. There is something that's not quite right. All people, all of us, inhabit more than one possible identity.
But the press overwhelmingly overall was anxious to portray Wilde as a queer, pansy.
Absolutely, they were.
And there's no national press, Fox, Yorkshire Press, who, in defence of him, and some version of, well, you know, that's another sort of man, as we'd say today, you know.
The major defences of him that were sort of semi-public or public were often, it's a mental illness.
Yes.
That was the closest they got, which even the Marquess of Queensberry accepted at one point later on. Mental illness.
Oh,
so you don't treat them as somehow guilty, you treat them as moral, it's insanity. Rather than
they were saying that Wilde was insane.
Yeah, yeah.
Well,
so
yeah, that was a common view, wasn't it? Yeah.
But Josephine Butler said the same sort of
morally
hate the sin,
yeah.
Love the sinner was her Christian response, and she assumed he was insane because otherwise why he was taking those acts. What interesting thing is none of the big kind of socialist movements and things of the time defended him in any principled kind of way. Even the ones that were imagining a new society where we would live very, very different relationships, not even in bourgeois marriages and things like that. No, none of them took that on board, even though they could have done in various kinds of ways. Even if they did it in quite formal, rational ways in order to deflect attention from them as a sort of identified with him.
They weren't too good at defending women at that time, were they?
No, and the New Woman was also in the paper all the time, and so there were other issues that people were worried about and were destabilising. Mm-hmm. Questions?
Yes.
Obviously, they were both Oscar Wilde and Grace were popular Victorian figures. Probably Wilde, in the end, were very controversial. But can you refresh my memory? Was ever considered, or why wasn't considered Grace for such a thing as a knighthood or an honour?
there was endless discussion in the press between about, because there was an honours list that came out, I'm not sure exactly when, about June 1895, a sort of regular honours list. And there was regular discussions about, well, for us, one, Lewis Morris, the poet, became Sir Lewis Morris. And Punch was saying, who the hell is he? If he gets one, WG should get one. Also, political party functionaries getting ones and saying, why should you give it to these people who do nothing, just sit on their asses all day? Give it to somebody who really deserves it. They were much more nuanced in talking about Henry Irving's knighthood. What they tried to say is there's an equivalence. This one performs on the board, this one performs on the sword, equally great, so if he gets it, why shouldn't he? One of the explanations offered in the secondary literature on grace is there were difficulties with the Rosebery administration. Rosebery wasn't particularly a cricket supporter. He was much more focused on racehorses and that kind of stuff. So it hadn't occurred to him to put him on there. The timing wasn't quite right also to put him on at that particular point. People also talked about him becoming a lord. And in fact, in that Lord's reform around 1911, he was actually listed on a list. When we were going to flood the House of Lords with liberal peers, he was listed as one of those possible liberal peers. So you could have had W.G. Grace at the House of Lords. But yes, they raised this question. And in the end, kind of sour grapes, they sort of said, he didn't get one. Oh, he's bigger than that. He doesn't need a knighthood. And Punch pursued that, but they didn't pursue it kind of, as other people have said, single-mindedly. They talked around it, but they didn't start or push the debate further than many other publications did. But yes, it definitely was debated.
Well, I think perhaps got to finish now, but I'm sure Neil would be happy to speak to anyone who would like to have another word with him after this. So, people.